This is the second lecture on the physics of flight, and we looked at the lift force in the previous lecture, and we said there's a price to pay for this lift force, and that's the drag force. And in this lecture, we'll look at the horizontal forces, the drag and the thrust force, because the thrust force is how we counter the drag force. So which forces act upon a plane? If a plane is flying, constant altitude, constant speed, then we have three forces acting on it. We have the aerodynamics force, pointing up and backwards. We have the thrust force, pointing forward to counter the backward component of the aerodynamics. And the weight, of course, which needs to be countered with the aerodynamic force and then the lift component. These three forces are often drawn as four forces because we use two different components of the aerodynamic force and use the direction of the speed to decompose it. So everything perpendicular to the speed in horizontal flight, this is also the weight. The lift and weight are the forces perpendicular, orthogonal to the direction of speed. But in the direction of speed, we have drag and thrust. And we'll look at drag and thrust in this lecture. For a constant altitude and constant speed, there has to be equilibrium. Lift is equal to weight, thrust is equal to drag. And in a more physical way, we then write L is W, T is D. But remember that the drag is a result of the lift also. So these are connected. So lighter weight is less lift, is less drag, is less thrust, is lighter engine, maybe less weight. And so they're all connected and there's a lot of cycles in there. Let's look at the lift force again. We had this formula for the lift force. So is there a similar formula for the drag force? The drag force is a component of the same force. So the formula is indeed also very similar. It's actually the same formula for the drag force as for the lift, except we have the drag force D and we have the drag coefficient CD. Why not use the frontal surface of the wing? Well, remember that it's a component of the same force and the lift is an important factor of this drag. So therefore we use the same surface area as seen from the top view of the wing for this equation. This drag coefficient is also a function of the angle of attack. And the drag is the price to pay for the lift. So what is the ratio between this price and the gain, the lift? If we look at the formulas, we see they're almost equal. So the ratio between the two means that if we divide lift over drag, then we get actually just the two coefficients, which means independent of altitude or speed, this ratio is a given for a certain angle of attack, a certain flow, a certain shape. If we make a graph of this, so what is the amount of drag that we get per lift, that we see it actually increases quadratically with the lift coefficient. We also see that the number of the drag coefficients is way lower than the lift coefficient. And this is good news because the drag is the price we need to pay. So we get more than we pay. If we take this one point illustrated here, we see that we get a lift coefficient of 0.60. But we only pay with the drag coefficient of 0.03, which means that the difference, the factor between the two is actually 20. So our drawing is not at all correct. If we would draw it to the right proportions, it would more look like this. 20 times as much lift as the price we pay. It's not energy out of nothing because the aircraft doesn't move in the vertical direction. So there's no work done by the force because energy, the work done is force times distance traveled and we remain at the same altitude. But it's still impressive. 20 times. Part of the reason of this is that the wing design. We have become better at wing design over time, so that's why we can achieve this high lift of drag ratios. And actually, a thicker wing is better. So you see one of the developments over time is thicker wings. If we look at the ratio of drag per lift a bit closer in a mathematical way, there is a formula for this. It's a quadratic formula. We call this the drag polar. So it's the zero lift coefficient plus a constant times the lift coefficient squared. And if we look at this constant a bit closer, and I'm not going to go into details, but I just want to point at one character that's in there, that's the character A, and that stands for aspect ratio, or the slenderness of the wing. And this means that if the wing is a more slender wing, then the price that you pay for the lift is actually less. So if we look at some existing aircraft, the Boeing 747-400 has a factor 15 times more lift per drag. And the example of 20 is actually the value for the A380. More slender wings, better lift over drag ratio. In fact, if we look at gliders, they have extremely slender wings. then the factor is even 50 times as much lift as you get drag. So you can achieve a lot there. So there's two tricks to generate a lift for a low price of drag: slender wings and thick wings with a very good shape to generate lift. But still, there's a price to pay. And this ratio, this thrust over drag ratio, gives us the price to pay. By the way, this ratio is also the same ratio for the amount of distance you can still travel for a given altitude. So in a 747, if the engines fail, you can still, and you fly at 10 kilometers altitude, you can still fly for 150 kilometers. But there's a price to pay. How do we pay it? With the thrust. So how is this thrust generated? If you look at the Wright flyer, the Wright brothers had a problem. They needed an engine of which all the engine manufacturers around the world said it doesn't exist. The Wright brothers said, well, then we have to build it ourselves. And so they built their engine. In fact, the same can be heard nowadays for a lot of new forms, new engine, new propulsion forms. But be aware that in 1940, when the jet engine, the gas turbine, was new, that all the experts that existed in around the world were assembled in the gas turbine committee in the U.S. National Academy of Sciences. They said that even with all improvements possible, it will always be too heavy in the airplane. At the same time, they were already doing experiments with it. So you see this often, that some people say it's not possible. And even physicists say, like Lord Kelvin, say it's not possible to fly. Or these guys were also physicists, it's not possible. But be aware that often they're thinking about this way. It's not possible in this way. But there has to be another way then, right? Let's look at this jet engine then. How does it work? Well, there is a core part which compresses air, burns fuel, and then the air expands at a higher temperature. And this is the core principle to generate lift, because if you expand at a higher temperature, it gets so much more speed that it actually can cause thrust, the thrust force, the propulsion. There's also a certain amount of air going around this hot section. And if you look at today's engine, actually that part is way larger. That's called high bypass ratio, so a larger amount of air, cold air, is going around the hot section in the center. Why is this? Is this to make them cleaner, quieter, or is it simply to save fuel? Well, therefore, we have to look at the physical principles and we have to understand a few concepts. Let's look at this poor guy pushing his car. He exerts a force at the car, and in this way, he gives the car energy. And when over time, he has performed a certain amount of work, but per time unit, he has to have a lot of power to do this, in this case, because his car has no power. So using these concepts on the jet engine, we can explain a lot about the jet engine. The propulsion is generated, the thrust was generated by accelerating air that goes through the engine per second. So we have a mass flow, a certain amount of air that goes through the engine, which leaves it with a higher speed. And by changing the mass and speed, the product of those two is called momentum, by changing the momentum, you can create thrust as a reaction. So the thrust is the mass flow times the speed difference. If you look at power, power is the amount of work done per second, and work is force times distance. And distance per second is speed. So by multiplying the force with the speed, we can get the power available for propulsion. And this is the mass flow times the speed difference, is the thrust force. So multiplied with the speed of the aircraft, which is the same as the speed of the air coming in, we can calculate the power available for thrust. What we have to pay is, of course, the increased kinetic energy of the flow. Kinetic energy is half mv squared, and so per second, the amount of change per second, is the mass flow half mv squared. So if you maybe you remember from high school, half mv squared is the kinetic energy. Then you know that this is actually the difference. But what I'm getting at is I want to know the efficiency. So I look at the gain per cost. And the gain is propulsion power. The cost is the extra kinetic energy in this case. And we have derived this formula for that. And by doing some manipulation of this formula, including brackets, writing the square in a different way, and deleting parts on the top and bottom side of this fraction which are the same, one important step is that actually the mass flow drops out. And the equation for efficiency of the jet can be written like this, only as a function of the speeds entering and leaving the engine. And if you look at this equation, We see that the jet efficiency is therefore given as 2 divided by the ratio of the speeds plus 1. And there's no mass flow in this. Unlike the thrust force, where there is a mass flow in there. So if we want a high efficiency, then the top equation has to be a high number. So the lower part has to be a lower part of this fraction has to be a lower number. And therefore, the V out has to be low. But we needed this V out, this high V out, to generate thrust. But if we have more mass flow, it doesn't cost us any efficiency, but less V out, we can still generate the thrust we want, but with a higher efficiency. In other words, it's better to accelerate a lot of air a little bit than a bit of air a lot. And this is why engines are getting larger. You see here of 2 different types of A320. The A320neo actually has larger engines. And the same for the 737. The 737 MAX has larger engines, which meant they had to put it slightly forward because they wouldn't fit under the wing anymore. Summarizing, from aerodynamics, we learned that, yes, you can generate lift with the wing, but there's a price to pay with drag. And if you do it efficiently, you get 20 times as much more lift as drag, or maybe even 50 with the slender wings. And if we look at the cost we have to pay, we can counter that with the thrust. And then accelerating a lot of air a little bit is the most efficient way to do so. And that's why engines are ever getting bigger. I hope this provides a little bit of insight in the basic physical principles of flight. And this is the end of this second physics lecture.